Tetuli mukisera cha mirembe, tetuli mukisera cha kwera gana na akamu, tuli mukasera kazibu, nolwecho katukakwate n'obuvunaanyizibwa obukwachi, obusembayo. Mwebale nnyo okumpuliriza. My Lord, the Party President of FDC, the Honorable Engineer Patrick Oboy Amriat Poa, Wasabirigwa, the Chairman of the FDC Electoral Commission and all the commissioners. Chairman of FDC is none other than Toterebuka Bamwenda. All of you leaders of our great party FDC in your respective capacities, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen.
One Uganda! One people!
It's always a great pleasure, an emotional moment for me whenever I am here at our headquarters, Najja na Nkumbi, the headquarters of our struggle. I would like, therefore, to first of all thank all of you, especially our gallant fighters in the struggle who have fought. Many of you are carrying injuries. Some of our colleagues are not here because they are maimed. I wish to thank all of you for holding fort and fighting on till this moment. I would like to thank our leaders of the Forum for Democratic Change that have steered our party through turbulent times, when many thought it would go down, it keeps going up. So I'm very indebted to all the successors that followed me in the leadership of the party, including those who are no longer here with us, like my brother General Mugisha Muntu and his friends who departed from the party. We still recognize their contribution to this party and to our struggle. I would like to thank the membership of FDC who constructed a struggle for the liberation of this country. Forum for Democratic Change are not just to transfer power from those who captured it by force, and so that we can talk of people rule and not gun rule as we have today. You can see, since I left my home in Kasangati, I am escorted by all kinds of soldiers. I am not an armed person. I am not a violent person. I am not involved even in any violent activity. But when you see outside, you think that there is maybe the biggest enemy of Uganda residing at Najjanankumbi. This abuse of power, use of guns to subjugate our people, is what our struggle for democratic change is all about. It's a struggle that I joined when I was a kid, and that I have fought with a lot of challenges up today. So I thank the people of FDC, the leaders, the members at all levels, who have withstood all the tremors, all the challenges, the force, the intimidation, the brutality, to be still standing strong for democratic change. I thank you and I congratulate you upon that valor that you have demonstrated. Last night, I had Mr. Museveni concerned that some NRM members were assaulted during the youth elections. And he was charging, we shall not allow this, we shall crash. Shame on him. He has never known how many of our people have been terrorized, tortured, and beaten. He has never known. And killed who are in their graves. When the Kiboko squad was descending from Central Police Station, did he think they were going to beat beasts or taxpayers that account for his luxury of the money they steal with impunity? And he's worried that some NRM people are beaten by other citizens. When we are tortured by people, we pay our money. So thank you. Thank you for remaining firm. Liberating a country is not easy. Thank you for being there. And for saying no to those rogues that control our country today. I would like to inform you that, you know, that struggle which I joined to fight gunmen has taken various phases to get where we are. And if we want to get to where we are going, we must understand where we are coming from. The experience that we have accumulated is not experience that is useless. It's experience we must build on to take us forward. I started the struggle myself through armed fighting, through holding guns and fighting. And I can tell you the war we fought, which has been totally desecrated and turned into the most disastrous thing that our country could have had, was a just war that we went to. We went to a just war to fight for our freedom. Fighting for freedom is the most noble and just cause. Every person that is created by God is given right to freely exist like any other person. It's not granted, it is only granted by God. So when you take away my freedom, I must fight for it. And we went and fought with guns. And as a result of that war, 500,000 people perished during that struggle. But yes, freedom has a cost. We did not lament because we thought it was a just cause leading us to freedom. But as you know, as soon as we got into government in 1986, these rogues now calling themselves a government turned around and did 100 times worse than the people that we had fought. And some of us protested, said we could not have risked our lives in order to do worse than those we were fighting. Because me, I was never a politician. I was a medical doctor. The reason I went and spent years hungry, sleeping with mosquitoes and all kinds of animals, was not for a person, it was for my freedom. It was for the freedom of Uganda. So when our colleagues betrayed that struggle, some of us rejected and started right away challenging them. And some of you have not been around to see those different phases that we went through. 2001 election. Even in 2001, I was not really meant to be a candidate. I became a candidate by circumstances, just the last hour. Because I was retired from the military in October, and that October I became a candidate for an election in February. But that election of 2001 was a major turning point in what was going on. It is still the most violent election we have had in Uganda up to today. Many people died, many were wounded and so on, arrested, terrorized. That time there were no parties. Parties were not allowed to sponsor candidates. Everybody was an individual. I stood in the election of 2001 as an individual. There was no FDC, there was nothing else. People who rose up to support me were just supporting elect Colonel Kizza Besigye, that was all. There was no organization. But our people fought, and through that fight, some changes happened. Because even in spite of having only 3 months, I believe we won that election, 2001. And we went to court. And court confirmed that there was widespread cheating and there was no free and fair election. Court in its unanimous judgment, there were 5 judges then in 2001. All the 5 said this was not a free and fair election. And they listed all the terrible things that happened. Unfortunately, when it came to the most important thing of deciding whether that election should be cancelled, again, because of some weaknesses, the court was divided in the middle, 3-2. 3 judges voted to uphold that sham election. Because that is subjective, it's not based on any yardstick. It is each judge to decide subjectively after making all the findings and so on, each judge subjectively. And we know what influences those subjective changes. So 3-2, they upheld the election. The violence continued until I ran out of the country. I spent 4 years in South Africa. FDC was formed when I was in South Africa. And the leaders of FDC thought that I could still come back and help in the struggle of that period. And I accepted and came back in 2005 October for the election in February. I was nominated here. The Electoral Commission came here to register me on my way from Entebbe. On the 26th of October, that's when they registered me as a voter here for an election. I think that time it was on the 11th of February. And then, 2 weeks later, on the 14th of November, I was arrested and charged with rape, with treason, with terrorism, with illegal possession of guns. Me who had just arrived. And sent to Ruzira. I was given bail from Ruzira. The court was attacked and said, you cannot get out. Stayed in Ruzira with bail, but not able to get out. I was eventually nominated from Ruzira as a candidate. I got bail in January for the election in February. And even after coming out of jail, I was in court being tried for rape up to the election time. But our people fought. FDC had just been formed to what had the weak structures in the country. But our people fought extremely hard. And I am sure we won that election. Many people have said so, including those who were on the other side. Who are these people who desert? That's what their first message is. By the way, you won. Why didn't you say when you were still there? We went to court. Same as 2001, everybody confirmed. That time there were 7 judges. All 7 judges confirmed this election is not free and fair. This is a record that will never be wiped away. A record on the election of Uganda. It's there. For you, anybody can go and read it. 7 judges unanimously. This election is not free and fair. You read the constitution. The constitution allows only one election in Uganda. A free and fair election. But even after writing it in their judgment that this is not free and fair, they failed to cancel it. Even in 2006, it was a divided court. 4-3. 4 judges saying they should keep it, 3 judges saying it should be cancelled. And the election stood. From 2006, but after the 2001 election, part of that struggle is what caused the return of multi-party elections. Because when Museveni got scared of the challenge from within NRM, those who were here, you may remember his missives. He said Besigye did not consult our organs. So then it became organs to decide the candidates. And all this, his mistakes are what were taken by Omulodi here and his the Honorable Paul Kawanga Semogerere, who led the petition. They compiled all the evidence and took it to court. And the court said, no, this is not a no-party system. It's a one-party system, which is not allowed. And that's how we got parties to function. So every election, though it does not lead us to where we are, it adds on something. So in 2006, when all that happened, those of us who were here decided that now, in the past two elections, we have only had 3 months to prepare. Now we have 5 years to prepare. So let us have no excuse whatsoever. Let's go and prepare for an election. Because really what we wanted was that we give a chance to orderly electoral transfer of power. Orderly, as provided in the law. That's what we wanted to give the regime a chance to do, to step down in an orderly way. But that they abused. So in 2011, we had enough time. I went to every sub-county of Uganda between 2006 and 2011. And in many sub-counties, I went to many parishes of those sub-counties. We rebuilt the structures of FDC from the grass up to the top. That's why we had an early delegates conference in 2009. My first term as leader of FDC lasted only 4 years. The reason was that we didn't want to go with shaky structures to 2011. So we built from the grassroots up to the top. And in 2009, we had a delegates conference to re-elect national leaders. That's the first time I contested with Gen Omuntu. So we went to 2011 prepared. We even fundraised and paid nomination fees for every candidate of FDC from the grassroots up to the top. We paid lawyers' fees for those who needed affidavits and whatever. We paid everything and even printed posters for some of our candidates. We ran a very strong campaign in 2011. Of all the 4 elections that I have participated in, what the Electoral Commission has been giving me, which is fake, that is when they gave me the least votes in 2011. Of all the 4, that's when I got the least. What they read out was the least that I have ever got. Much less than when I had only three months and no structures. So in 2011, we realized we need now to shift the gear. From just looking for orderly electoral transfer of power to now really fighting for our right and our power. Are we together? So a gear changed in 2011. And that's when we started walk to work. Remember? 4GC, FOC. At that stage, I also realized that leading FDC alone and being busy with FDC work would not help that struggle that we had engaged. Because that struggle needs a lot of time. It needs everyone who is oppressed, not just those of FDC. Everybody who is oppressed must be part of that struggle. And so in 2012, I asked my colleagues here to allow me to step down as a leader of FDC. 3 years to the end of my term. We had a lot of debate. There were emotions like I was seeing here this morning. Saying, how can you leave the leadership of FDC? But I explained that we are not in FDC for the sake of FDC. We are in FDC to liberate ourselves, Uganda. And FDC and those non-FDC, we must see how to liberate this country. And as I told you, that gear we engaged in 2011 of struggle, fighting, could not be done just as a party activity. It had to be done by all, whether you have a party, whether you don't have a party. If you are oppressed, we hold each other's hand and we advance. So I stepped down. After a lot of struggle also here, and a new party leader was elected. Some indeed thought I was leaving the struggle. They were saying he has abandoned. Kala tulese wakati munyanja. Never. I can never. I just changed the position. And that's why, especially you fighters, you must be flexible. If you are fighting from this position and the enemy identifies where you are, they are going to concentrate the fire where you are. You must therefore never stay in one position for a long time. You change the cover. You must change
cover.
Change cover. They must not predict what you are doing or where you are. So, in 2012, I stepped out of Najjanankumbi. That's why I was extremely happy. Many people, especially out there, the loudspeakers of the rogue regime, we are predicting doom. Hey, now Besigye has gone, FDC is finished. Hey, that's what he's finished. Is it weaker or it's stronger?
Stronger!
Alhamdulillah. Stronger. But the struggle outside is also stronger. So yes, we went out. I was fighting shoulder to shoulder with the Lord Mayor. He was not a member of FDC. We've been fighting shoulder to shoulder with many people who are not necessarily members of FDC. And that's what makes the struggle much stronger. I had actually said that even in 2016, I would not go to the election of 2016. When these processes were going on, I was out of the country. But I had not left the struggle. And I would not want to reveal on this occasion what attracted me to come back in 2016. It was not because my assessment of what elections do had changed. No. But I made an assessment together with our colleagues that there was a greater danger that we needed to deal with, which at an opportune time we shall have the freedom to talk about. Now, in 2016, because of those reasons, I came back to the election. But now I came back with both gears. Are we together?
Yes.
With the gear of the struggle and the gear of the election, the campaigns for elections. And that's why some of you who listened to my message during the campaigns or the message of our party, we were telling Ugandans that actually the country they were talking about getting a leader for was not in their hands. That the country is not in their hands. This country is not in the hands of Ugandans. It's in the hands of the gunmen that captured it and who use it arrogantly, act with impunity, steal with impunity. I don't think this country will ever have looters or plunderers like these plunderers led by Mr. Museveni. Has never happened. These billions they are now squandering here, they just stole from stock, from borrowed money for COVID. They are using COVID money to rent support. So in 2016, as I said, we did not go into the election as usual. We went into the election with the two gears. We prepared our people throughout the campaign. We prepared our people to fight. And there is absolutely no doubt about the support of the people of Uganda that we got in 2016. Even foreigners, even locals, even NRM, they know that we defeated Museveni flat in the elections. They came here, raided headquarters, kept it solely for themselves. For 3 weeks, they were the ones in charge of our headquarters. For 3 weeks. They had hoped to capture the declaration forms that we had got in 2011. And they captured a few. But I can assure you, without the slightest form of doubt, that the greatest majority of the declaration forms of 2016 are in our possession. And that's why, and we can use what we have in our possession to demonstrate to anybody that it is us who won that election. And that's why we were demanding an audit in 2016. Even some foreigners offered to audit the election so that we give them our evidence, and whoever else challenges us brings theirs. Our friends, the Swedes, stepped in to help. We even signed the memorandum agreeing to audit, which is in our possession, the memorandum for audit of the 2016 elections. Then Mr. Museveni knew that we were now pressing him against the wall. He chickened out. Said, I'm no longer interested. Even after he himself had also signed, accepting an audit. So there is no doubt that Mr. Museveni is totally illegitimate as the leader of this country. As you know, they took me to jail, charged me with treason for declaring myself a winner. And I went to court and said, yes, it's true, I declared myself, here I am. Try me. Let me show you that it is I indeed who won, that's why I declared myself. It's now 5 years. We are going into another election. They have never tried me. I am still a prisoner on treason. Never tried. Because they don't want the truth to come out. And since 2016, then the desperate Mr. Museveni has been rampaging all over the place. He then created the new electoral commission, this one. He created it while not supposed to be in office himself. This Byabakama commission itself is illegitimate because it was set up by an illegitimate man. Who has continued to tamper with it? Even in the middle of this particular election, Mr. Museveni has sacked some of the electoral commission senior staff. Museveni attacked Kasese. That was election violence. Because we had humiliated him in Kasese. Even with their cheating and whatever, the gallant fighters of Rwenzururu, of the Kwanyarwenzururu in Kasese, fought and took every elected position there. He knew this was a bad example and went and attacked Kasese. The king of the Banyarwenzururu is still in prison here in Kampala. From 2016, hundreds of the people of Kasese are in jail up to now. Hundreds are in mass graves in Kasese. That's 2016. He did not stop there. We were lucky the country was given a bonus when the Americans arrested a man that brought bribes to them, a man called Chi Ping Ho. The money he brought was also for elections. The evidence is there in part of what he was tried for in the court. The evidence is there that he was contributing to an election. Bribe from the Chinese man. Kutesa, who took the bribe, is still our Minister of Foreign Affairs, painting shame wherever he goes in the world. Then, Mr. Museveni would not be on the ballot today if it was not for the attack on Parliament. Because the Constitution wouldn't allow him to be there. He took forces, that's why I say it's the gun rule. Took the military into Parliament under the clear view of all your cameras. And that's how we have now a new constitution. When the whole country was singing Toji Kwatako, I am glad that the Judah Iscariot Majesi seems to have been hounded out of his village. I hope all those who similarly betrayed the country can be hounded out of wherever they are. Because they are the enemies of our country. Since then, that's how Mr. Museveni now took money from government to go and campaign to be a solo candidate. Parliament gave him, I think it was 50 billion to go and campaign for Soru candidate. 50 billion. They were paying every NRM person who appeared 100,000 shillings. Was it 300? Trust the Ugandans, at least they shared into that, because they would wait outside the meeting and grab it from them. So that is how we have come to where we are. Now for us in 2016, when I came out of jail, together with our colleagues here, we decided to now strengthen the struggle platform by forming the People's Government. The People's Government has been working day and night with one task: to end the illegitimate hold of power by Mr. Museveni and the rogue government he leads. That is the mission of the People's Government. And we have worked, I can assure you, we have worked hard all these 5 years. There have also been some interferences with our work, some from the regime, some from outside the regime. But we have withstood them and remained focused on where we are going. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are at another crossroads. When the junta, the gunmen, are organizing another election to legitimize themselves, that's what they are doing. I told you that in 2016, both my hands were busy. This one engaging the election gears, this one engaging the fighting gears. That is not very efficient. Election gears are our plan A. The fighting gears are plan B. And plan B is white. Plan B is quite white. It's involving. It is my humble decision that I have discussed intensively with my colleagues that we get somebody to lead plan A and you leave plan B for me. Never ever imagine that I can leave the struggle. Never. If we felt that again moving with both hands is the most efficient way, maybe we would have done that. But trust my judgment. This country will not be free by Byabakama or whatever he's called going to Kololo to announce that there is now a new winner who is not Museveni. And for Museveni to come with his heart and hand over power. Those who are waiting for that day, when Mr. Museveni will come humbly and thank Ugandans for all the things that we have done for him, without our permission, of course, he will not do so. It is our duty to make make sure he lives, whether he wants or not. It's our duty. That duty becomes ever more urgent. It is very, very urgent that we do that. Our people are dying all over, dying needlessly. This COVID lockdown has shattered the lives of millions of our people. Even as we stand here, many of our activists have nowhere to sleep. They have been kicked out of houses. They have nothing to eat. The whole country is crying. Young people have no livelihoods. We are living at a time when Ugandans are pouring fuel on themselves and burning themselves up. Hussein Walugembe in Masaka started it. 27 years old. Burnt himself in a police station where they had detained his boda-boda, the means of his survival. I am still deeply pained that other boda-bodas just kept listening and, you know, that became history. Because boda-bodas in this country have what it takes to take over government within 1 week. Alone. Boda-bodas can take over government within a week alone. Why should you first burn yourself to death? What lacks is the information of what to do. That means. But many people here in Kampala, as I talk, I know I think about six people that have burnt themselves to death. Here, in Masaja, there in Nakulabye, many burning themselves to death out of desperation. So it's urgent. We have no luxury saying, you know, we go escort Museveni, you know, around, and he beats us. We must engage him on all fronts very, very strongly. Very strongly. And I can tell you, me, I've never woken up to do anything else except to watch how this thing can come to an end. It's my full time, 24/7. I don't have any other engagement. So I cannot be talked over as if I am leaving, going somewhere. No. I will work myself flat out to make sure that we can regain control of our country as quickly as possible. And I am sure it can be done. In fact, I'm sure it can be done even before there is nomination for this country. It's possible. It's possible. The regime is finished. I told you, even the money they are using now, they borrowed it for COVID. They don't have any money of theirs. What they are using to pay these soldiers has just been borrowed from World Bank for salaries. Just borrowed it. That is not a government that disturbs us for long. The whole country is crying for change. Mr. Museveni no longer has any support except the ones he rents for cameras. security people you see. And that's why sometimes I want us to engage them tactically. They are even more annoyed than we are. They even want change faster than we do. These soldiers, have you seen where they sleep? Where, how their families live? You don't need to go far. Just go to any of these barracks and you see how their families live. You know? They have nowhere even to wash their bodies from. They wash from the road at night. To clean themselves. So actually the soldiers are also waiting for us to take the initiative so that our country can be free. Yes, I had last night, I don't know where things are in Mali, that the leader there was under detention. If they stay long enough, there is no other way it will happen to them, whether I am available or not. So ladies and gentlemen, the fight is on. The fight is on. Two channels that you must listen to. Two channels. Channel A and channel B. So some will be operating from channel A, others will be operating from channel B. But channel B, mark you, supports channel A fully. Are we together?
Yes.
We support channel A, our channel A fully. Because in any case, all fighters can vote. Not so?
Yes.
But not freedom and right. Every Ugandan should be a fighter for their right and freedom. And once they are fighters, we can win, whether election, whether no election. There is no reason why we should wait for an election. For a Mr. Museveni who didn't come through an election anyway. Is it an election which brought him? Why should he expect that we will wait for his rigged election to get rid of him? So, kindly. Sibalaba. Warm up. We are building a strong front for change. In the plan B, we move with everybody who wants change, whether you have a party, whether you don't have a party. Get on the front line and we push. That is our platform. So we have a platform that will unite all people who are for change to fight. I told you when we were here to receive Omulod here, that we must keep our eyes on the ball. Let's not allow to be diverted. Their tactic now is to distract us. People abuse you, you run after them. These ones abuse you, you run after them. Let them abuse, keep the eye where the ball is, and let's get rid of that ball. All these people who are making noise on the sides, once the ball is gone, everybody will get down. Are we together?
Yes.
So fighting is tactics. Let's maintain our eyes on the ball. So today, I came here, ladies and gentlemen, to be part of you as we flag the process of the Channel A to continue. I can tell you without a shade of doubt that I have every confidence in our leaders that we have here today. Mulongo Waswabirigwa is not new to the challenges of Channel A. He has been in the trenches there. He has been in the country. He has also been abroad. That's why he has the title ambassador. So he has friends that we hope he can now invite. If they are friends, this is the time they have to come. We need a lot of support at this critical moment. So Mulongo here is welcome to this process. I think it's a good decision that you took to step forward for your country. Some people think that becoming a leader of any form of struggle is a joke. That it is, you know, desirable, you aspire to it, you fight to become a leader in the struggle. But if you test it, you will know that it's not entirely a cup of tea. But I trust Mulongo Waswabirigwa is up to the mark, and I congratulate you upon taking the decision to express interest. I believe I don't need to talk much about our president, the one and only Poa. Poa has been in national politics for decades. There is no corner of this country that he doesn't know. He's also had experience in public service even before coming into elections. As you know, he's an engineer. He first made roads and things like that. Came into public service, in electoral service for people in his area. And he's a quiet but decisive person. Some people mistake his demeanor as being maybe a pushover. Well, those who tried know how. If there are people out there underestimating him, think again. Because he's full of surprises. Yes, I mean, to come from wherever he came in those humble situations and find a general, former commander of the forces, leading a strong party, and in a short time things change, is no mean achievement. So I have absolutely no doubt that Poa fits the bill. The few years he has been in charge of the party, he has never left the front line. Whenever there has been a tough area, he has been there. So he doesn't command from behind, he commands from the front. And I thank him for taking this challenge and setting the ball rolling. Now, there are still a lot of unknowns ahead of us. in this process, there are many unknowns. Nothing is clear, nothing is fixed. It's a lot of fluidity. So we all must remain alert to make adjustments wherever they are necessary to fit whatever situation that we deal with. And as I have said, I am available whenever you need my hand, whenever you need my advice, whenever you need my input, I'll never hesitate. So ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude by thanking God, because the fight is the Lord's. The fight is always the Lord's. Just like our lives are for the Lord. We don't have the ultimate authority. And I can trust, I can say to you without any fear of contradiction that the Lord we talk about, we believe in, is always on the side of justice. The Lord is for the just. So let's set off. Let's continue trusting and believing that we are also supported by higher powers. COVID is demolishing the whole world. We are still safe by the grace of God. So by His grace, we shall reach where we are going. I thank you and I wish you all the best. Let's remain firm. Let's never be diverted. We shall overcome. We shall?
Overcome.
We shall?
Overcome.
One Uganda?
One people?
One people? God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we take this opportunity to this gentleman here and those who are going to represent us in the next phase. But they are one Uganda, one people. They are opponents, but they are not fighting each other. Ask them. National, ask them, please.
One Uganda.
One people.
Oh, Uganda. My president, Dr. Kano Chizabesige.